can't honestly believe that I'm from the tribe of Judah and once hid out in ancient Egypt, which is in northern Africa. All 12 tribes look the exact opposite of me, but yet the masses are still dancing around in Wonderland. I and those who help me push strong delusions have an agenda, which includes mixing up the tribes. Matthew, the 13th chapter, tells you how the wicked one sows tares all over the world, which is his offspring. Watchman and Deborah have pulled together some facts that will hopefully get your attention. Don't deceive yourself with foolish lies.
Where are the 12 tribes of Israel today, and who are they? Though many believe that the so-called Jews represent all 12 tribes of Israel, the fact is they don't represent any of the tribes. They are actually Jewish converts to a religion called Judaism. They are not the descendants of Jacob, the father of the Israelites. So if they are not, how can we identify who they are today? Here are some biblical clues that will help you to identify who the 12 tribes are.
Deuteronomy 28, verse 45 and 46. Moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee, and shall pursue thee, and overtake thee, till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of Yahuwah thy Elohim, to keep his commandments and his statutes, which he commanded thee. And they shall be upon thee for a sign, and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever.
The scriptures make it clear that the curses of Deuteronomy 28 would be a sign upon the Israelites. Many people, including our people, knew that something was wrong with us, we just couldn't pinpoint it. Caucasians were teaching that it was the curse of Canaan, Ham's son, that was on us. But we know, according to the scriptures, that prophecy was fulfilled when the Canaanites became hewers of wood and drawers of water for the Israelites. So when we read the curses of Deuteronomy 28, we know that this does not fit the so-called Jews as dwelling in the land of Israel today. Also, the scripture states that once the true Israelites are back in their land, that they would not learn war anymore, and that the whole world would be at peace. Instead, we see wars all over the Middle East, all over the world even.
Micah 4, verse 2 and 3. Many nations shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of Yahuwah, and to the house of the Elohim of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of Yahuwah from Jerusalem, and he shall judge among many people, and rebuke strong nations afar off. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore." Isaiah 14, verse 5 through 7. Yahuwah have broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the rulers. He who smote the people in wrath with a continual stroke, he that ruled the nations in anger, is persecuted, and none hindereth. The whole earth is at rest and is quiet. They break forth into singing.
The 12 tribes of Israel are all Negro. They fled into Africa because they were Negro. There are many that claim that the 12 tribes of Israel were a mixed race people. This claim is based on two factors. One, the handmaidens of Laban, Bilhah and Zilpah, were they Negroid or Caucasoid? The scripture doesn't mention the genealogy of Bilhah and Zilpah, but we know for certain that their offspring only married with Negroes. We know for a fact that they were not Caucasoid, but Negro. 2. Joseph married an Egyptian, which we know for certain that their offspring were Negro as well. Thus, there were no offspring mixed Caucasoid among the children of Israel. The so-called mixed multitude that left out of Egypt still would have been called Negro in appearance, because the children of Israel were not mixing with the Caucasoid. Using Joseph and Moses as an example to claim that the marriage to foreigners was permitted, it is important to note that the law had not yet been established. We know that the law explicitly forbids the marrying of foreigners.
Throughout the Bible, we can see very clear indicators of what is prophesied to happen to the Israelites. Although they've had many captivities in the past, in the last days there is a specific prophecy that would affect only the tribe of Judah.
Isaiah 11, verse 12. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations, and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth.
In Isaiah, the 11th chapter and the 12th verse, it was said that the outcast of Israel would be assembled together, and the dispersed of Judah would be gathered from the four corners of the earth. Outcast meaning put out of the land of Israel, and dispersed meaning sent into slavery. While Israel was outcast from the land, Judah was the only tribe to go into this final captivity, but will be gathered from the four corners of the earth. From here, we can draw a direct correlation to the transatlantic slave trade and figure out where the tribe of Judah went.
Only one of the 12 tribes was actually shipped into captivity, and that was Judah. And the scripture makes that quite clear. Judah and Israel were separated. And it was Judah that committed an abomination against the Most High.
Ezekiel 37, verse 21 and 22. And say unto them, thus saith Yahuwah, Elohim, behold, I will take the children of Israel from among the heathen, whether they be gone, and will gather them on every side, and bring them into their own land, and I will make them one nation in the land upon the mountains of Israel, and one king shall be king over them all, and they shall be no more two nations, neither shall they be divided into two kingdoms any more at all.
And under the leadership of wicked kings, Judah had forsaken the one true Elohim. And the people worshiped idols and practiced the same wickedness as the other nations that surrounded them.
Ezekiel 8, verse 15 through 18. Then said he unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn ye yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner court of Yahuwah's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of Yahuwah, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men, with their backs toward the temple of Yahuwah, and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the east. Then he said unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Is it a light thing to the house of Judah that they commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence, and have returned to provoke me to anger, and lo, They put the branch to their nose. Therefore, will I also deal in fury. Mine eyes shall not spare, neither will I have pity. And though they cry in my ears with a loud voice, yet will I not hear them.
The Most High sent Judah into captivity because of the abominations he committed in worshiping the sun, and scattered him throughout the four corners of the earth. And the scripture makes that quite clear.
Job 3 verse 6. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. Zechariah 1 verse 21. Then said I, what come these to do? And he spake, saying, these are the horns which have scattered Judah, so that no man did lift up his hand. But these are come to fray them, to cast out the horns of the Gentiles, which lifted up their horn over the land of Judah to scatter it.
Now throughout the Bible, we can see very clear indicators of what is prophesied to happen to the 12 tribes of Israel. Although they've had many captivities in the past, in the last days there was a specific prophecy that would affect only the tribe of Judah. Outcast meaning put out of the land of Israel, and dispersed meaning sent into slavery. Now Israel was outcast from the land, but Judah was the only one that was sent into this final captivity, but will be gathered from the four corners of the earth.
The tribe of Judah are the black Negroes that were shipped in the transatlantic slave trade to North, South, and Central America, Haiti, Cuba, Mexico, Jamaica, Portugal, Spain, West Indies, England, and other places around the world. Even though the indigenous people of some of these areas were black, they were conquered by Europeans, and because of the mixing of the seed between European males and black women, what we see today is essentially the creation of a third race.
When we were children, we were told that we have a motherland, and that motherland was Spain. However, we have discovered later in our lives that, as a matter of fact, we have several motherlands, and one of the greatest motherlands of all is no doubt Africa. We love Africa, and every day we are much more aware of the roots we have in Africa. Also, America is our motherland. Africa, America, and Bolivar used to say that we are a new human race in Latin America, that we are not Europeans, nor Africans, or North Americans, that we are a mixture of all those races. And there is no doubt that Africa resounds with a pulse like 1,000 drums.
Many of the descendants of the Negroes shipped into slavery to these places are still there and are still black.
North American Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves. South American Negroes, Colombia Negroes, Argentina Negroes, Brazil Negroes, Uruguay Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves, West Indies Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves, Haitian Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves, Cuban Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves, Mexican Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves, Jamaicans are Negroes, descendants of Negro slaves, Spanish Negroes are descendants of Negro slaves,
Portugal Negroes are descendants of Negro slaves. United Kingdom Negroes are descendants of Negro slaves.
Many of the descendants of the Negroes shipped into slavery to these places are still there and are still black. However, the images widely shown of Portuguese, Argentinians, Uruguayans, Mexicans, Cubans, Guatemalans, Panamanians, North American Indians, and Puerto Ricans are a mixed race people, and many confuse them with the indigenous by claiming them to be as such and ignoring those of dark skin. The indigenous seed has been whited out and replaced with a lighter skin, mixed seed of a European father and a black mother.
I'm not an Israelite.
See, now that guy definitely ain't no Israelite. He can't even pronounce the word right.
Who were the original inhabitants of South and Central America? Everyone would like to stake their claim, but the fact is that there was a population of people there prior to European invasions. The original inhabitants left many clues of who they were right on the walls of caves, monuments built, and other structures. There were even pyramids and what they call large Olmec heads of what the original inhabitants looked like. The Olmec heads are irrefutable proof that the people of the region had the features of so-called black people. With large lips, wide noses, and other features, it would be hard to deny the evidence of our own eyes as to who these people were. One could only draw a conclusion that the original inhabitants sailed here from the African continent.
There is a lot of confusion concerning who the 12 tribes of Israel are today. And this confusion is based on the so-called 12 tribes chart that's circulating among the Israelite communities. The chart is as follows. Judah, the Negroes, African Americans, Benjamin, the West Indies, Levi, the Haitians, Simeon, the Dominicans, Zebulun, from Guatemala to Panama, Ephraim, the Puerto Ricans, Manasseh, the Cubans, Gad, North American Indians, Reuben, Seminole Indians, Naftali, Argentina and Chile, Asher is Colombia to Uruguay, and Issachar are the Mexicans.
There are three main reasons, among others, why the so-called 12 tribes chart is invalid. In this segment, we will focus on the three main reasons, as the other points require more detailed information. Point 1. According to the Bible, the tribe of Judah would be the only tribe sent into this final captivity. The Bible also states that the tribe of Judah would be shipped all over the earth, which means northward, southward, eastward, and westward. The chart that is circulating shows all 12 tribes in this final captivity and only shows dispersal to two continents, North and South America. That is hardly the four corners of the earth. The tribe of Judah only have been sent all over the earth, living among different nations, speaking in many different tongues and languages, according to the lands that they were dispersed to. Those that captured these Israelites would not have separated them according to tribes, because they would not have cared about such things. Not to mention, by the time this final captivity had taken place,
Judah was already separated from the rest of the tribes as outlined in scriptures in many places. So the rounding up of Israelites by tribal name would not have taken place or been maintained by the slave gatherers. The scripture does not support this chart in any way, especially since the other tribes were not included in the final captivity. Although Israel was exiled from the land of Israel, only Judah was dispersed to the four corners of the earth. As the Bible has shown, in the last days, the other tribes will be gathered from regions of the earth that are not even included on the so-called 12 tribes chart.
The 12 tribes chart was created in order to justify Israelite men marrying foreign or non-Israelite women. If these men were really trying to keep the laws of the Most High, then they would know that even marrying outside of your tribe was against the law. So even if the so-called Latinos and South American women were Israelites from another tribe, in which we know they are not, men of Judah are supposed to marry the women of Judah. This chart and the teachings behind it is causing an increase in the sins of Israel. Many Israelite men who promote the 12 tribes chart talk about American black women in a degrading manner as though they are the scum of the earth. Why don't you get yourself a Haitian or Jamaican woman then? They're on the 12 tribes chart just like the Latinos, but I don't see y'all going after them. I think we all know why.
When you really think about it, the passage in Esdras actually fits the description of many of your modern African tribes. You have the Limba tribe, the Bimaliki tribe, and countless others that have more historical proof that the passage refers to them rather than a lot of the groups that are named on the so-called 12 tribes chart.
On the border of Black Africa, as the Nubian drummers played into the night, I was reminded of my work 20 years before with a southern African tribe called the Lemba. As far back as anybody could recall, the Lemba had claimed to be Jewish, effectively a lost tribe of Israel. Their oral tradition said they were led out of the Holy Land by priests at the time of the Babylonian invasion, and that they'd taken a sacred object they called Ngoma Lungundu with them.
You have people taking tidbits of information that have been dropped here and there, such as finding fragments of the Hebrew language in the Americas to claim that Latinos, North American Indians, and Mexicans are Israelites, when clearly they don't even fit the narrative of the people in mass who've been keeping the law of Yahuwah from the time of the Assyrian captivity until now. That describes people that are living in Africa right now. Now the Bible clearly tells you that as a whole, they would be walking and living according to the law which fits the tribes in Africa. It says from the time of that particular captivity, they would be upholding the law until the end times.
I hadn't seen my old friend Raulinga for many years. He's one of the guardians of Lemba traditions and was keen to remind me of the uniqueness of his people's culture.
We adore and worship Yahweh, the only one. We don't adore ancestral spirits. We don't worship idols of animals, trees, stones, the sun, the stars, or the moon, which Yahweh has made. Culture is the backbone. It's a unifying force. Now, I know culture changes in accordance with time and place, but the root of culture remains the same. You see, now we have lost touch with our people for about 2,600 years now.
The Lemba were convinced that they were a lost tribe of Israel. The problem was that no one believed them. They appeared to be completely African. But I discovered a number of mysterious legends and customs that were very un-African. Men from other tribes were not allowed to marry into the Lemba. They refused to eat pigs and certain other creatures. They practiced the ritual slaughter of animals with a special knife. And they circumcised their male children at an early age.
Now, the majority of Mexicans and mixed North American Indians and Latinos don't even claim to be the Israelites. What you do have is a very small few individuals who were recently told this lie by so-called black Hebrew Israelites.
This chart and the teachings behind it is what's increasing the sins of Israel.
This unfounded theory is causing a lot of confusion to those who don't understand how a biblical seed line is established for the Israelites. Now, even though biblically the pedigree is established through the father seed line, you're only an Israelite when both parents are at least of a third generation lineage. The following passage will bring clarity to this fact.
Numbers chapter 1, verse 18. And they assembled all the congregation together on the first day of the second month. And they declared their pedigrees after their families, by the house of their fathers, according to the number of the names, from 20 years old and upward by their poles.
Now notice, there was an assembly of the congregation to establish this fact. And we all know that this assembly was Israelites only. And when you look in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 7 through 8, it clearly tells you that the children that are born of those that are not Israelites cannot enter into the congregation of the Most High until their third generation.
Point number two. Another point of this segment is that the so-called blacks that were already in these lands prior to the invasions of Europeans were not Israelites, but the children of Ham. The Israelites did not come until later during the transatlantic slave trade. The signature of the Hamites were all over the land as evidenced by the culture and the architecture of the region. To assume that the so-called black people of any area are Israelites by default is to disregard other factors that prove otherwise. As in the case of the Moors and the black Native Americans, there is no evidence that these groups were indeed Israelites. The whole idea would completely go against what Scripture has shown. The Israelites have not had any power to stand as the Moors did, nor did they occupy any territories en masse without some type of subjugation as the dark-skinned Native Americans were able to achieve. The fact remains that the so-called Native Americans and other South American cultures identify more with the children of Ham and not the Israelites. Point number three. The final point in this segment is that the mixed race people of these regions shown on the charts were fathered by European men. Hebrew men were being subjugated and castrated and did not father the children of those regions en masse. The European males fathered the majority of the people of these regions and caused a process of blanqueamiento, which is the whitening of a dark population of people by mating with them.
When you have so-called black people saying that we're more related to Mexicans or Latinos than we are to Africans, it shows a great imbalance of perception and common sense. Now, we're not saying that some of our people weren't shipped to some of these areas. We do realize that. But people are really trying to rebrand Spanish people as Israelites. You have to understand that many of these people have a Spanish male lineage. They came from men from Spain. They were not fathered by Hebrew men, but Spanish men. You can't deny that the appearance of a person has a lot to do with their lineage. It's a very revealing factor in a person's lineage, as a matter of fact. So when you really look at these people and at their own admission, many of them actually come from Spanish males and not Hebrew males or so-called black men.
You are not the father.
This point further disproves the infamous 12 tribes chart and the fact that the images of the people being circulated are not Negro, but a mixed offspring of European males and black females. The slaves that were sent to these regions were indeed Negroes from Africa upon arrival. After the raping of black female populations, the offspring was that of European men. As the children of these European men would grow and mate, they would mate among themselves or back into a European bloodline, which further lightened the gene pool.
You can't just toss aside the historical proof that these people have more of a Spanish origin, as the majority of them choose to breed amongst themselves or back into European lineage.
Many of them did not mate with the Hebrew male slaves.
So again, the majority of the groups named on the so-called 12 tribes chart come from the lineage of European men, not Hebrew men.
It is important to note that the so-called black people that were already in the land prior to the transatlantic slave trade were not Israelites, but the children of Ham.
So you have two things going on. You have the so-called black Native Americans that were already here prior to European invasion. Now, they were raped and subjugated by European men, which created a mixed population of so-called Native Americans.
What did Columbus do when he first made landfall? Quote, rape, murder, and enslavement. Again, the record is solid. Like, the record shows that there are letters written from his best friend, the person closest to Columbus, where he's describing how it was just on a normal day. He just rapes women on a normal day. Like, they'll show up, he'll force them to be naked. At first, sometimes they struggle, and then he whips them, and they don't struggle, and then he rapes them. And then there was one line about how, by the time I was through with her, it's like she was taught by a group of whores. Ugh. Okay, his lead priest who was with him, same thing. They would casually have conversations about how they enslaved the people and how they murdered people on a regular basis. I love the irony of these people viewing themselves as Christians.
Situation: Old Mexico is ripe for conquest. Mission: seize land, resources, and native peoples. Execution: lead 500 well-trained Spanish conquistadors. Administration: in the name of the King of Spain. Command and control: Captain General Hernan Cortes. Nearly 500 years ago, Spanish conquistadors began their conquest of the Americas. The most successful of them all was Hernan Cortes. When Cortes and his men first landed in Mexico in 1519, they carried weapons like this, finely tempered Spanish swords. The people he faced, the Aztecs under Montezuma, were still using relatively primitive weapons like this obsidian blade. Now, obsidian is sharp, but it's very fragile. No match for Spanish steel.
April 1519. The Spanish mission to conquer Mexico is in big trouble. Its leader, conquistador Hernan Cortes, is facing mutiny from his own troops. They want to end the expedition at Veracruz and return to Cuba, but There's no turning back for Cortez. And he'll make it impossible for any retreat by committing one of the most daring acts in the history of conquest. He burns his own ships. Now, the only option for his soldiers is victory or death. And victory depends on the leadership, diplomacy, audacity, and cunning of one man, conquistador Hernán Cortés. Cortés knew that he must leave his homeland to seek the fame and fortune he desired. He took his chance alongside other Spaniards sailing to the New World. In 1504, 19-year-old Hernán Cortés landed at Hispaniola, a Spanish colony now known as the Dominican Republic. At age 25, Cortés became a friend of a well-known conquistador named Diego Velázquez de Cuellar. Cortés joined Velázquez in his conquest of Cuba. By 1511, Cuba was conquered, and Velázquez became its first governor. Those who came with him, including Cortés, were rewarded with land on the island. Soon, Velázquez made Cortés magistrate of Santiago.
He was not a very wealthy man, but one of the most important people on the island of Cuba.
On behalf of the King of Spain, Velázquez sent expeditions from Cuba to Mexico. Cortés's ambitions were fueled by stories of the great Aztec Empire. He felt certain this empire held all the riches of the New World. He'd seize this land and become as rich as a king. He'd be known and respected by Spanish society.
Hernán Cortés, the famous Spanish conquistador, arrived in Veracruz in 1519. Then he headed to Mexico City, which the Aztecs called Tenochtitlan. One of his fellow conquistadors was a free black man named Juan Garrido. I'm following in his footsteps. Cortés was dazzled by the city's overall beauty, by its irrigation system, but especially by its gold. He brutally conquered it. Today, Mexico City is constructed on top of ancient Tenochtitlan. With over 21 million residents, it's the largest city in the Western Hemisphere. I've come here to find treasures too. But these are housed in the National Museum of Mexico.
So what are you taking me to see?
We are going to see the Casta paintings.
The Casta paintings.
By the end of the 17th century, interracial relationships were on the rise. The Catholic Church allowed marriage between all groups. The law granted freedom to the children of black slaves and indigenous women. White men increasingly impregnated black women.
Now, the offspring of these European men cannot be branded as Israelites, which is what many are trying to do.
We've got to remember that much of the mixed offspring of white slave masters and black women bred among each other and established a whole new third race. In many of these areas, such as Brazil, Mexico, and other areas of South America, the offspring of white males was an intentional act to breed out the black. The majority of them did not breed back into black populations in certain areas, especially South America. Those that did breed back into black populations were due to the slave system of a particular area, such as here in America. The following illustration will hopefully bring clarity to those who wonder how so-called black descendants of slaves can claim to be Israelites with the presence of white slave masters' blood.
Notice, if you will, the half-caste child. And there are ever-increasing numbers of them. Now, what is to happen to them? Are we to allow the creation of an unwanted third race? Should the coloreds be encouraged to go back to the black? Or should they be advanced to white status and be absorbed in the white population? Now, time and again, I am asked by some white man, if I marry this colored person, will our children be black? And as chief protector of Aborigines, it is my responsibility to accept or reject those marriages. Here is the answer. Three generations. Half-blood grandmother, quadroon daughter, octoroon grandson. Now, as you can see, in the third generation, or third cross, no trace of native origin is apparent. The continuing infiltration of white blood finally stamps out the black color. The aboriginal has simply been bred out. Bred out. Bred out.
What we have here is three generations. Half white man, quadroon woman, and black boy. Now, as you can see, by the third generation, or third cross, no trace of white origin or genes is apparent. The continuing infiltration of black blood finally stamps out the white color. The white slave master's color has been simply blacked out.
On the 12 tribes chart, it says that the West Indies is Benjamin. Do you know what the West Indies is? The West Indies is the islands of Cuba, Jamaica, Hispaniola, which is Haiti and Dominican Republic, and Puerto Rico. Wait a minute. The chart says that the West Indies is Benjamin. So let me get this straight. Based on what they're saying, that means that the Jamaicans, the Haitians, the Dominicans, the Puerto Ricans, and the Cubans are also Benjamin? Can you see the confusion that's coming from this chart? Also, the chart says that Gad is the Native American Indians, but the Seminole Indians are Reuben, which are also a part of the Native American Indians. It has been shown that the Native Americans, the Hispanics, and the Mexicans all have the Neanderthal gene, and blacks don't. Also, Zebulon is supposed to be from Guatemala to Panama. But according to the 12 tribes chart, Colombia is supposed to be Asher, when Colombia was actually a part of Panama. You have white North Americans and you have black North Americans. There are white Cubans and there are black Cubans. There are white Colombians, white Mexicans, and white Latinos, and there are black Colombians, Mexicans, and Latinos. What makes you think that they're all the same?
European ancestry dominates in the whole of Brazil in all regions, accounting for 65.90% of heritage of the population, followed by the African contribution of 24.80% and the Native American at 9.3%. Sao Paulo State, the most populous state in Brazil, with about 40 million people, showed the following composition. European genes account for 79% of the heritage of the people of Sao Paulo, 14% are of African origin, and 7% Native American. European ancestry also dominates Colombia, with Spanish European population at 86%. Black, including mulatto, is only 10.6%, and Native American at 3.4%. Guatemalan mixtures of mixed Native Americans and Spanish Europeans is 59.4%, making the indigenous community in Guatemala about 40.5% of the population. Indigenous meaning of African descent. The areas between Guatemala and Panama are pretty much the same. As for Uruguay, Europeans are 88% of the population. Mestizo, Spanish, and Native American mixtures are only 8%. Blacks are only 4% of the population. And Native Americans are 1%.
Wait a minute. 88% of the population of Uruguay are Europeans? And 86% of the population of Colombia is Spanish and Europeans? The indigenous only make up about 10% of the population. So how is it that this region ended up on the chart as Israelites?
It's the same with Cuba. 65% of the population of Cuba is European of Spanish descent. 23.84% is mulatto, and only 10% black.
Blacks were forbidden from using African instruments in dancing at carnival. African religions and ritual drumming sessions were banned. A 1906 immigration law appropriated $1 million to whiten Cuba, bringing 600,000 Europeans, mostly from Spain, here to the island over the next 20 years. Black culture, an embarrassing relic of Africa and slavery, was repressed, forced to live underground. President Machado's endorsement of soul was part of a larger cultural phenomenon. Cuba's white establishment stopped pretending that it was a Caribbean extension of Europe and began celebrating its racially mixed or mestizo heritage. This movement was called Cubanidad, a blend of white and black to make brown.
Cabanos is Spanish for Cubans. The majority of Cubans are descendants from Spaniards. Take a look at Ricky Ricardo, you know, from the I Love Lucy show, Desi Arnaz, he's a Cuban. You mean to tell me that people that look like Jennifer Lopez are Israelites, but the people of South Africa are not? This chart is causing Yah's people to commit a great sin. Those that were shipped to West Indies were Judah. Many are saying that the Native American Indians are Israelites because they wore fringes, and that they found fragments of the Hebrew language on a rock. I say, so what? Does that trump the word? The Japanese, Chinese, Spanish, and French, and even some of the people of the Middle East had fringes. Does that make them descendants of Israelites because they had some fringes? Of course not.
Across all the civilizations living in Mesopotamia from 3000 to 300 BCE, fringes were a popular and important decorative adornment for the clothing of both men and women. It is believed that the fringe was worn by all classes of people. The evidence for how the fringe was used and what it looked like is found on sculptures, statues, and described in the writings left by these civilizations. People actually wore fringes and tassels all over the world. We call them fringes, but others call them tassels. Between Roman emperors and contemporary fashion designers, tassels have a long history of ornamental power. People wore tassels in France and Spain. In Egypt, Mesopotamia, and throughout the Arab world, tassels were worn by children on hoods or caps to protect them from malevolent spirits and to ward off demons. The samurais of ancient Japan hung tassels from their swords, and in Central Asia and the Middle East, tassel-embellished clothing and accessories were found.
Also, another fact is that these Israelites will be keeping the laws and statutes of the Most High until the latter times. The Native Americans, Mexicans, and Hispanics were not and are not keeping the laws and statutes of Yahuwah. The only few that even believe any of this are those that have been told this deception by some Hebrew Israelite. Many of them had and still have heathenistic practices. Let's take a look at the Native American witch doctors. Who do they resemble culturally? And where did they get this cultural practice from? The children of Ham. This is the cultural practice that's directly linked to the Hamites and not the Israelites. The truth is, the original indigenous people of America and South America are actually descendants of Ham, but they have been whited out. This is why you see the pyramids of Africa, Mizraim, in South America. This is why you see Indians looking like the witch doctors of Africa. Notice how these images of South Americans looking just like Hamites, with huge jaw plates in their mouth and huge plates in their ears. Let's just face the truth. They're not Hebrew Israelites, but Hamites, descendants of Ham. The real reason behind the 12 tribes chart is quite obvious. If you really do your research and you check those that's actually pushing this chart, you'll see that they have Hispanics and Caucasians as wives. This is the true reason why they're even pushing this chart, because they're trying to justify themselves being with a foreign woman when the scripture strictly forbids it.
The claims that the three Jews that traveled with Columbus was to help him interpret the language of the so-called Native Americans was just more conjecture and lies to help establish a link between the natives and the Israelites. Remember, Columbus thought he was sailing to India, not America, and this is why he called them Indians.
It was just Indians, and they weren't even Indians. We called them that by accident, and we still call them that. Like we knew in a month that it wasn't Indians, but we just don't give a shit. We never correct it. We came here, they're like, hi, and we're like, hey, you're Indians, right? And they're like, no. No, this is India, right? No, it's not, it's a totally other place. You're not Indians? No. Ah, you're Indians.
Is Arsareth America?
2nd Esdras, chapter 13, verse 40 through 46. Those are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoners out of their own land in the time of Hosea the king, whom Salmanazar, the king of Assyria, led away captive. And he carried them over the waters, and so they came into another land. But they took this counsel among themselves, that they would leave the multitude of the heathen and go forth into a further country where never mankind dwelt, that they might there keep their statutes, which they never kept in their own land. And they entered into the Euphrates by the narrow places of the river. For the Most High then showed signs for them and held still the flood till they were passed over. For through that country there was a great way to go, namely a year and a half. And the same region is called Azareth. Then they dwelt there until the latter time.
There are many who claim that the Israelites traveled from Jerusalem to America before the land was ever populated, and that they were the true indigenous people of America. This belief has three basic claims. 1. In the Apocrypha in 2nd Esdras, it says that the Israelites traveled to a place called Arsareth. 2. It's also claimed that Columbus identified America as Arsareth. 3. Lastly, they claim that the Native Americans had Hebrew customs. First, we will deal with the Columbus claim. The Jewish Encyclopedia states that Columbus identified America as this land called Arsareth. It also names the source of this information as being a book called Christopher Columbus by K. Serlings. If you research for yourself, the claim is actually false. On page 15 of this book, it doesn't claim that America is Arsareth at all, but only states that he, meaning Christopher Columbus, was fond of reading the Bible and the fourth book of Ezra. That was all. Even if the statement turned out to be true, Christopher Columbus is no authority or reliable source on the matter, especially when he thought he was landing in India. Therefore, any claims that Christopher Columbus would make should certainly not be considered factual statements as it relates to the geographical location of any territory.
The Jewish Encyclopedia lists the source of this information, and it gives you the name of the book and the page where it supposedly mentions that Azareth is America. This is a complete lie. Many people won't do their own research and check out the source of this information because it's listed in an encyclopedia. We take it for granted that every word of an encyclopedia is true, and that's not so. Now, I have the digital version of this book on our site at WatchmanReports.com. At the top of the site, there's a tab called Media. Scroll down on the drop-down menu and click on Files. The file is there to download for free. It's called Christopher Columbus PDF. Also, once you download the book, you can go to the page that's mentioned in the Jewish Encyclopedia and even search the word Azareth throughout the entire book. The word isn't even in the book.
Another very important piece of information deals with traveling in ancient times. The following facts simply can't be ignored as it relates to how long it would have taken the Israelites to go into this new land. The distance from the Euphrates River to El Ayun, Western Sahara, which is the West African border, is 3,410 miles. Because of the rough terrain and desert conditions, it would take approximately 45 minutes per mile to walk. The Israelites would have had to walk 8 hours or more per day, which is about 10 miles per day, to stay within the specified time frame of 18 months. Because of hunting and searching for water, they would have also needed to take at least 3 days off per week, since the Sahara Desert covered the entire area they walked. Based on the distance of 3,410 miles, it would have taken them the full 18 months or year and a half to walk within Africa.
Wow. Once they got there, did they build ships? No. According to the scriptures in 2 Ezra 13, they passed through a narrow passage and Yah held the floodwaters back, right? Isn't that what's being taught? Or did they build enough ships to carry them over to America? We know it wasn't no ferries waiting on them there, right?
Now, to get to America from the west coast of Africa would have taken another 3,994 miles, totaling 7,404 miles traveling by foot. The fact is, it would have taken at least 3.5 to 4 years to travel, and totally impossible for them to make this journey in 18 months. The promoters of this unfounded theory teach that man had already dwelt throughout Africa, so it couldn't have been referring to areas in Africa. Let's listen to what British historian Basil Davidson had to say when exploring regions of Africa.
Now the task was to stake out frontiers in utterly uncharted land. Said the French Prime Minister, "We have embarked on a gigantic steeplechase into the unknown." The British Prime Minister, Lord Salisbury, was to say of this period, "We've been engaged in drawing lines on maps where no man's foot has ever trod, where no man's foot has ever trod, where no man's foot has ever trod."
Where no man's foot has ever trod? You mean to tell me that there were certain places in Africa that no man has ever dwelt in those days? What about in 727 BC? Of course there wasn't anyone dwelling in certain areas of Africa in 727 BC when Shalmaneser, the king of Assyria, reigned. This was only about 1700 years after the time of the flood. If there was no one dwelling in certain areas of Africa in the late 1800s, then we know for sure that there was no one dwelling in certain areas of Africa 3700 years ago.
Based on what the Bible says, the Israelites were fleeing captivity, but were still in or near the African continent or the Middle East. The only significant body of water they encountered was the Euphrates River, as mentioned in the Bible. It is from there that they traveled a year and a half, and based on the travel information already presented, it is impossible that Arsareth was anywhere near America. Here are some other very important facts that simply can't be ignored. 1. The Bible did not say that the Israelites crossed an oceanic body of water, or that the Most High parted the water for them to travel on dry land across any ocean. Only that they would travel through the narrow parts of the Euphrates River. 2. In order to travel to America, they would have needed ships that were not mentioned in the Bible, only that they left the multitude of the heathen and went into a further land. 3. Even if they did have ships, to transport all 10 captive tribes, it would have taken them more than 18 months, or a year and a half, to build enough ships to carry all of them. Also, for those claiming that they went up northward first, and then back down into America through Alaska and Canada, here is more information to disprove that theory. From modern Iraq, which is ancient Assyria, to Nome, Alaska, is 5,499 miles. From Nome, Alaska to the United States is another 3,344 miles. That's a total of 8,844, which would take even longer to travel within the 1.5 year period mentioned in the Bible.
The one fact that I want to bring out is this distance was gathered from the internet, and it was based on traveling by airplane, not by driving or walking. An airplane can travel straight to its destination. But if you're walking, it's a whole different scenario. You have to take into consideration the mountain and the hills, the valleys, the different bodies of waters and rivers that you may have to cross or go around. Not to mention, many of these areas were already occupied by hostile foreigners. It would have taken more than 13,000 miles to get to America in at least 5 to 7 years to travel by foot. This is a fact. Now, my question to you is, where is Gozan? If you look at a map, Gozan is on the other side of the Euphrates River if you're in Israel. They were in Samaria, according to the scripture, and Shalmaneser, the king of Assyria, carried them over into this area of Gozan.
2 Kings, chapter 17, verse 5 and 6. Then the king of Assyria came up throughout all the land and went up to Samaria and besieged it 3 years. In the 9th year of Hosea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried Israel away into Assyria and placed them in Halah, in the harbor by the river of Gozan, in the cities of the Medes. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 9 through 12. And it came to pass in the 4th year of Hezekiah the king, which was the 7th year of Hosea, son of Elah, king of Israel, that Shalmaneser, king of Assyria, came up against Samaria and besieged it. And at the end of 3 years, they took it, even in the 6th year of Hezekiah, that is the 9th year of Hosea, the king of Israel, Samaria was taken. And the king of Assyria did carry Israel unto Assyria, and put them in Halah, and in the harbor by the river of Gozan, and in the cities of the Medes.
Now, let's go back to the scripture in 2 Ezra 13.
Those are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoners out of their own land in the time of Hosea the king, whom Shalmaneser, the king of Assyria, led away captive. And he carried them over the waters, and so they came into another land.
We know for sure that the other land that was mentioned in the scripture had to be Assyria. Why would Shalmaneser, the king of Assyria, lead them to any other place than his own land? They were in Assyria. Why would they go north
or northeast into a colder climate, into the land of Esau, where the Caucasus Mountains in that direction. Why would they even go in that direction?
But they took this counsel among themselves, that they would leave the multitude of the heathen and go forth into a further country where never mankind dwelt, that they might there keep their statutes, which they never kept in their own land. And they entered into the Euphrates by the narrow places of the river.
They went in the direction of their homeland, Israel, because the scripture specifically states that once they were in that area, that they crossed where? The Euphrates River. So they had to go back to Israel. But instead of stopping in Israel, they went into a further country. That's Africa. The scripture states that they, the children of Israel, entered into the Euphrates by the narrow places of the river, which proves that they went in the direction of Israel and not in the direction of the Caucasus Mountains that many are teaching. Then they went into Africa.
For through that country, there was a great way to go, namely a year and a half. And the same region is called Azareth. Then they dwelt there until the latter time.
Just like the scripture says, to this day, there are so-called Africans, which I believe are Hebrews, that are keeping the laws and statutes of the Most High in Africa to this day.
To answer the question, I have to turn the clock back some 2,700 years to the time of the mighty Assyrians. Back then, Assyria was the greatest imperial power the world had ever seen. And it had set its expansionist sights on the northern kingdom of Israel. The northern kingdom, composed of 10 tribal groups, was completely destroyed. Any surviving Israelites were enslaved and taken to Assyria, what is now the nation-states of Iraq and Syria. Little is known about the fate of these lost tribes, but for 2,700 years, hope remained. Could the Israelites have regrouped? Could some have escaped their captors and fled? Could a group of wandering Israelites have survived the elements and continued on, faithful in some land far from home? The Lemba story goes like this. Thousands of years ago, they were forced out of Israel and settled in a place called Sena, which is believed to be the present-day Yemen. There, they lived as traders and craftsmen until war or natural disaster pushed them across the Red Sea and into Africa. Then began a slow migration south. Along the way, according to the Lemba, they built great stone cities. It's a claim that's fascinated archaeologists.
Cultural identity is a social construct. No genetic data is going to tell you that you are Jewish, or that you are Hindu, or that you are Christian, or any religious domination.
Himmler tells me that the presence of the Kohen modal haplotype can't tell us anything about the Lemba's religion. Yet just as remarkably, it can tell us where their ancestors came from, and it's not in Africa.
There is this interesting genetic information showing us that some of the original founders did come from other parts of the world other than Africa. From our data, I would put my money on saying it's the Middle East.
Himmler is convinced that Lemba ancestors did indeed come from the Middle East. We've seen how science has backed up the claims of the Lemba in the face of years of doubt and prejudice. The archaeological clues, the DNA evidence, and the Lemba's own oral history add up to a very convincing argument. It reminds me that first impressions can often be misleading. It was hard to believe that a tribe of black Africans could be the descendants of ancient Israelites. But that's exactly what they appear to be.
Brother and sisters, they are there. We are not lost. We are scattered.
We are original Hebrew.
This is one of the maps that's used to push the lie that Azareth is America. The distance that this map shows is more than 10,000 miles for the Israelites to travel, and would have taken them 7.5 years. There is nowhere in the passage of scripture that mentioned anything about them traveling by ships. Even if it did, it would have taken the Israelites more than 1.5 years to build enough ships that are large enough to carry them all the way to South America.
It's high time for us to awake out of our sleep, because it's clear that the world knows something about us that we simply do not know. You're about to see a series of clips which highlight statements made by European Jews and so-called white people. In these clips, they're going to acknowledge the fact that so-called black people are the original Israelites. However, these confessions are not without some type of string attached. Although there is an acknowledgement of who we are as a people, there's still an attempt to add false narrative to it. In other words, they say that we represent most or some of the tribes, and they still try to connect themselves as being one or more of the tribes. So pay attention to that as you watch these clips. Up next, some very eye-opening information about the real tribes of Israel. It's time to open your eyes.
And I'd like to now bring up another interesting place that you're finding descendants of the Israelites, but may not necessarily be from the 10 tribes, but will also play a role. And shouldn't be overlooked, it's a very serious scenario, is in Africa. Africa has perhaps hundreds of millions of people with this identity right now, of being from the people of Israel. We're taught by the historians and within our own traditions that when the Romans conquered Judea, a few hundred years after that the tribes of Israel went into exile, perhaps millions of Judeans were sold into slavery. Into Africa, into Rome, deep into Africa. And if you look now, you're seeing people who are most likely the descendants of those slaves who kept true. I'd like to bring up a few specific examples, because they're going to be game changers. One of them wrote letters to Israel when it became a state. And they said, we're Israelites out in Africa. You know, everyone laughed at them and they said, African Israelites, these people are just trying to jump on the first world country bandwagon. They're living in a third world country, they got nothing. We're coming to Israel, we got innovation, technology. So they're trying to get on this train because there's such a thing called the right of return. All descendants of the Jewish people from around the world were able to move to Israel. So they said, we are also. And everyone kind of laughed at them, like I said. And a few people took it serious and went out there and started studying them, learned about their culture. And a professor from Duke University went out there and did DNA testing on them. And he showed not only did they share Semitic genes from people who were in Yemen, back to the Middle East, these gentlemen, a large percent of them, have the Y chromosome to be Kohanim, to be priests. Now, if anyone doesn't know, a priest is a specific family clan of the nation of Israel who come from Aaron, the brother of Moses, who was the first priest. And anyone descended from Aaron has the status title priest. And we found that these men in this village in South Africa called Lemba, L-E-M-B-A, carry this genetic marker to let us know that they share the same as from the Sephardic and the Ashkenaz and the population of the people in Israel today, they share the same exact DNA marker. That's mind-blowing. So everyone kind of got humbled a little bit who laughed at them and said, now what? Now what do we do about this? This could have tremendous implications. Another area in Africa you have something big happening is in Nigeria. You have the Igbo people, or Igbo, pronounced either way. There's 40 million of them, also Christians, like I spoke about before, how that could happen to the children of Israel very easily. But also, a lot of them are now coming out and converting back or adopting the rules of the Torah without all the paganism that they've been practicing for hundreds of years. There's been books written about it from scholars in Nigeria, from scholars from the Jewish people. And where it gets interesting is, in America, there was a slave trade. And a lot of the slaves, a very high percentage of them, came from Western Nigerian ports. And in America today, you see a very large movement of African Americans who say that they're the real chosen people, that they're the children of Israel, they're the Judeans. You know, so what are they just trying to create an identity for themselves because they were slaves, or is there really something here? And the answer is most likely there is something there. And most likely, maybe that they were the original Israelites, and maybe that the Jewish people today who are white Caucasian people came in a little bit later on. We know that some of the greatest sages of the transmission of the Torah were converts from Rome. You have a man named Uncalus who wrote a commentary on the Torah, unprecedented, that we still learn today. He was a convert. Some of the largest pillars on the transmission today were Roman converts. So here we are, we're Caucasian Jewish people. And now you have people in Africa saying that they're the real people of Israel. It can't be ruled out at all. We know they were sold into slavery. We know now that they're fulfilling prophecies by saying, we're coming back.
In a book called Hebrewism of West Africa, author Joseph J. Williams documents the Hebraic practices, customs, and beliefs which he found among the people of Jamaica and the Ashanti of West Africa. He initially examines the close relationship between the Jamaican and the Ashanti cultures and the folk beliefs. He then studies the language and culture of the Ashanti, of whom many Jamaicans have descended, by comparing them to well-known and established Hebraic traditions. The West African tribal nations that our forefathers were taken from have many ancient Hebrew customs in their culture. The Kafir, Bo, Gribo, Marybuck, Mavumba, Akra, Fanti, Akin, Yoruba, Congo, and Ashanti, just to name a few of the many sub-Saharan nations that engage in ancient Israelite rituals. In East Africa, in the country of Ethiopia, lived a people called Beta Yisrael, which means House of Israel. These brothers and sisters claim descendant from the biblical Israelite tribe of Dan. Dan was one of the 12 tribes of Israel. Beta Yisrael are black-skinned as an Israelite would be. They were given the name of Phalashas, which means stranger and foreigner. Beta Yisrael is not indigenous to the country of Ethiopia. This is why they are called stranger by the inhabitants of that land.
Let me just reveal some things. First of all, is that the Jews who were brought in Israel, most of them are white. Not most of them, almost all of them are white, including me. I was brought in Israel from a country which is called Bulgaria. It's a European country. And I can tell you that in every European country, there are Jews and there is so-called organization, Jewish Agency, which is trying to take those Jews to Israel. If you track this organization, you can find out that this is not an Israeli organization, this is an American organization. Jewish Agency is an American organization which has the exclusive right to decide who is Jewish and who is not on this planet and who to be taken to Israel and who's not. Now, if you do research, you will find out that in Africa, in Black Africa, they're looking for Jews only in Ethiopia. They bring Jews only from Ethiopia. And I can tell you by knowing a lot of people, Ethiopian Jews here in Israel, that they're treated very badly, very badly. And many of them commit suicide because they cannot take it. So they come from some place, Ethiopia, they don't have much there, but they live decent life. And they, when they come here and try to be humiliated and so on, some of them cannot even take it. Now, what I'm trying to say is that why from each white country this Jewish agency is trying to bring Jews, and when it's about Black Africa, they're going to Ethiopia, and this is where they stop. The only one place. Now, because of the same thing, they're trying to do the white supremacy here. They try to bring white guys here and to take the supremacy over Arabs, which are the local citizens, and over blacks, which are so far they're only the Ethiopian Jews. Now, what I'm trying also to say is that another question is why? Why America needs Israel? There is no oil like in other Middle Eastern countries. There's no nothing they can be attracted to. But why do they do all these things? Why do they invest money, bring white people and so on, and build their system of white supremacy just like in America they build in Israel? Why? And I can tell you why. Because the true Jews, according to the Bible, you can check it in the Bible, you can read Job 30:30 and some other places, they have never been white. They have been people of color. And they have not stopped in Ethiopia. They were in Ethiopia, Sudan, and they have settled in West Africa. From West Africa, they have been taken as slaves to America. Brothers and sisters, blacks of America, it's you. You are the true Hebrews. You are the true Hebrews from the Bible. America gonna do everything, gonna invest as much money as it has, gonna fight as much wars as they can, gonna invite as much weapons as they can just to hide this away from you. Gonna take Israel, gonna bring white people here and to tell you these are the Jews, gonna kill you, gonna kill Arabs, gonna mistreat white people like this guy just to tell you this lie that you are nobody and we are the Jews with all the history and so on. It has been deleted, your history. You don't know who you are. Don't forget about it. This is why America has been taking your history away, never to find out that it's all about you. I'm telling you this, please. I don't ask you to come to Israel and to start a revolution. I'm just asking you to start thinking this way, to believe me a little bit, because I'm living in Israel and I'm part of this injustice. I really believe that people like me and you, we can bring the justice back. Thank you.
Well, last time you spoke about the Jedi mind tricks, about it's the Jews that's running everything in the world. But today, we have a group of people who are so holy and they've been praying and fasting for weeks and weeks, and they've gotten this knowledge through the Holy Spirit that in fact the Jews are in fact black Africans. Okay. Now this is of course all over the internet, all over YouTube, and I just when I saw these videos, I just said, well, you know, what have I been doing with my life the past 30 years? I thought I was born again. You know, I thought I was a believer in Messiah and saved. Regardless of my background, if I'm Jewish or not, that I'm a spiritual Jew and so on. But this man explained that unless you're actually a black African, then you're not really accepted as a Jew. And I just got to say, it just makes total sense because, you know, the whole continent of Africa, you know, when Jesus was speaking about his second coming and as the lightning is the scene from the east into the west, then so will my coming be. And it's very obvious that to the east of Jerusalem, you see, is Africa. So it really means that the Jews are Africans. Okay, it just makes, the way he explained it, it was just like, wow, you know, so it must be the black Africans. They must be the true Jews. And basically, it's just really enlightened me today. I really thank all these people online that have spoken these wonderful truths. Over a billion black Africans, not white, of course, there are some white Africans, but they don't count because they can't be Jewish if you're white. So you've got to be black African. You know, it doesn't count if you're black Indian or, you know, black Hawaiian, whatever it is. You've got to be black African to basically be a true Jew. And just makes total sense, even though, you know, there's thousands of languages in Africa and cultures, and many of these Africans, I would say at least half, maybe more than half, didn't even see a Bible. Basically, they were called, as far as the Christian evangelists went. They were the last frontier as far as that went, because the gospel really hadn't been preached in many towns and villages and even countries in Africa until about the 1800s. But besides that, of course, that's not to say, truthfully, that 0.1% or something, some tribes in Africa are actually descended from the Israelites, but that's an exception to the rule, speaking truthfully now. But according to the internet sources, according to YouTube, and the vast intellect and, you know, wonderfully spiritual people that are on there, all that is just nonsense. In fact, they're Jews, they're from the tribe of Judah, and that's got to be recognized. So that's just a video recognizing that today, and thank you for listening.
In a book titled Traditions and Customs of Ga'adames of Ghana, Descendants of Authentic Biblical Hebrew Israelites, written by author Dr. Joseph Nye Abikar Mensa. The Ga'adames of Ghana claim through oral history that they are descendants of ancient Hebrew Israelites. They refer to themselves as Yudafoi, meaning they are Jews. This book traces the origins of Ga'adames and their migration from ancient Israel, following the attack of Israel by the Assyrians to their present abode in Ghana. The ancestors of the Ga'adames were ruled by Wulume, the high priesthood. Dr. Mensa discusses Ga'adame customs and traditions, including the Homowo festival, Otufu Dipo, circumcision and outdooring, sanctification, of the child after birth. These traditions and customs of Ga'adames are of Hebraic origins. Ga'adames' names are like genetic markers and are scattered throughout the Old Testament. Some of the names of their towns and villages bear Hebrew names. Tamar Kemp describes the Ga'adames of Ghana as descendants of authentic biblical Hebrew Israelites, whose ancestors once reigned supreme in the motherland. Dr. Mensa is the founder of Ga'adame Heritage and Cultural Foundation, born and raised in Accra, Ganyobi, Ghana. The author is quoted saying, "I had always wanted to know why my people call themselves Game, meaning Ga people. I learned they are of Hebrew Israelite origins, possibly from the tribes of Gad and Dan."
But I'm going to talk to specifically today about the black culture. And I wanted to right now, I know, and how many would agree, that I am not black. Can I get a witness, everybody? Amen. Praise God. Pretty white to me. Can I get a amen up in here? Yeah. Praise God. Amen. So here's the deal. But what I want to share with you is, I want to talk to you about, is that, you know, we went across the country and we found out there's certain things that help reach that culture and reach it effectively. And there's certain things that don't make it happen, okay? And today I would like to talk about those things that do reach the culture, specifically in the men of the culture. And the first thing I found out is this. I found out that they do not know their history. That's one of the things that I know. And so you have to tell them their history. So today I'm going to attempt to do that. Note number one is this. When we talk about the cultures, I always take them back to, of course, Israel first. Israel is the first thing I take them back to. And from Israel, I make the journey of the, of course, the dividing of the two kingdoms in 721 BCE, when the northern and southern kingdoms of Israel split. The southern kingdom, of course, made up of half the tribe of Levi, Benjamin, and Judah, making up what is called the House of Judah. Now just hang in there. They went, of course, up into Babylon for a short period and then returned to the land of Israel. Those are the sovereign Israelis that live in the physical land of Israel. The second one was called the Lost Ten Tribes, the Northern Kingdom, otherwise known as the House of Israel, or the largest numerical tribe called Ephraim. We've taught on it several times here. That those were scattered to the nations. Part of those, of course, went into Africa. Now, Israel wasn't originally called Israel. It was called Greater Africa. So these are the points that I begin to lay out. I begin to associate with the culture and reach into the culture itself, because its history is very deep. while in that course in West Africa, we talk about the history of that, and we talk about Dahomey and Benin, West Africa, and the three things that they attempted to do upon the black men, and that is in the black women, and that is they walked around the tree. How many remember the Detroit Tribal Revival? And they put three potential, they were never cursed people, but potential curses on those people, and that is of sexual immorality, financial instability, and utter poverty, and that they would forget their roots and where they came from. And that's what I'm going to be, my whole teaching today is on the third one there that I want to take a look at. Again, they attempted to put a voodoo or obia curse on them of sexual immorality, number two, financial instability and utter poverty, and number three, that they would forget their roots and where they came from. So one of the ways that you can identify with the culture is to begin to go into the culture and explain to them the obvious, why they would not know or see that in their own culture. All right, let's go into culture. So how are we going to reach this specific culture? Watch what happens. Now, we're going to pull up and we're going to talk about history. And we have to go back into their history to explain where they came from. And number two, in America, because we live in a democracy slash republic, many of you start out in the very beginning like, I don't really care. But by the time it's done, trust me, their life has changed. Amen. Let's go into right now. Let's follow the narrator right now. This comes out of, part of it comes out of a narration in Torah 201. You saw some of this with the history of the African people in the Bible. And what are we doing now? What are we doing right now? We're going in to identify culture. So today our feature is, of course, the black culture. Let's go into right now and follow the narration right now on it. And one, two, three, let's read it.
Africa, then and now. In ancient biblical times, Africa was known by many names. Number one, Akibulan, mother of all mankind, Garden of Eden. Number two, Kemet. Three, Libya. Four, Artiga. Five, Corfi. Six, Egypt. Seven, Ethiopia. Eight, Sudan. Nine, Olympia. 10, Hesperia. 11, Oceania. North Africa and Northeast Africa, now presently the Middle East, was linked by a strip of land called the Sinai Peninsula. The completion of the Suez Canal on November 17, 1869, severed the physical link that connected North Africa and Northeast Africa. The final separation came in World War II when the war correspondents coined the term Middle East to describe the area that now encompasses Israel, Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Oman, Yemen, Kuwait, Bahrain, Iraq, the United Arab Emirates, and Qatar.
Okay, now, so what happened was, is that now we're going to set the stage right now, okay? Look at your notes again. So what have we learned? That Africa did not have just the name Africa, isn't that right? Right? It had several names, so that's really critical. We understand that. We become familiar with those terms. And I'll tell you, so that what? So then when you sit on a seat on an airplane, we begin to open up a discussion, and we begin to dialogue with them. Now, Rabbi, why would you even concern them? I mean, like, who really cares about this? Well, in the last days is a prophecy, and we're seeing the prophecy being fulfilled. In Deuteronomy 30, verses 1 through 6, God said he's going to regather and ingather those who he has scattered to the nations. The Bible says he's going to bring them back to the land, making an aliyah to the land, and they're going to have a greater heritage in the land. Isn't that right? Amen? All right, moving on. Let's get going. And when people say that color doesn't matter to them, but it matters to someone who is an inner city, who has went through a struggle, who every time they walked into place, they were the isolated people, and etc. How many know that? Amen? And so you have to identify with the culture. You have to love the culture. You have to have a passion for the culture. You have to become knowledgeable of what's going on. Because sometimes the worst fight I find within the black culture is the black culture. They all fight amongst each other. Amen? So a lot of times we've just got to have them understand that God has a covenant promise for these people.
Amen.
And their covenant promise, even though part of that curse of the Obia curse, again, they were never cursed people, is that they would forget their roots and where they came from. So when we were in Barbados, I asked the whole crowd, a large crowd there, I asked them a question. I said, how many of you know Moses? And they all raise a hand. I said, so I'm going to ask you a question. If I asked you this, when you envision this, okay, tell me what color skin he has. Okay, you can see here the pin drop in the place in here. What do you think they said? White. And I said, well, that's interesting. I said, if I ask you the name Joseph in the Bible, what color skin would you say? Now, this is an all-black culture. This is all-black community. Okay, what do you think they said? White. Okay. If I ask them, who enslaved you in Africa, who do you think they said? Wow. I told them, you flunked every exam. So the next, write this down. The next thing I tell the culture is, of the 12 tribes of Israel, how many are black? Eight. Eight of the 12 tribes, so two-thirds of the tribes are black. So isn't it interesting? I asked them, how is it that if two-thirds of all of the 12 tribes of Israel are black, when I ask you about any of the people, you say they're white? Aha. Going back to, now walk with me, the third curse again, that you would what? Forget your roots, read it to me, and what? And where you came from. And part of the reason why, no offense, part of the reason why black churches don't teach this is because they don't want to get in the struggle either. They don't want to make it, quote unquote, racially motivated. People, this has nothing to do with racially oriented. I'm going to say that again. This has nothing to do with being racially oriented. This is biblical.
Amen.
I'm going to repeat that. This is biblical.
Amen.
These are biblical people.
Notice how you have to still be aware of that slippery tongue nature of those who stole our history. Some will not readily relinquish it back to us without attaching a lot of added information that is not historically true. But nonetheless, the world is starting to open up to the true identity of the Israelites.
Stephen S. Jacobs, a European Jew, has fully documented in his book called The Hebrew Heritage of Black Africa that the Hebrew Israelites, Jews of biblical times, were of black race and lived on the African continent of the world. His research is thorough and precise, contains quotations from many anthropologists, historians, and professors, and is complete with photographs, 7 pages of bibliography, maps, and illustrations. Stephen S. Jacobs has chosen to inform the general public about an ancient Hebrew heritage, which exists for many West African ethnic groups. Historically, we can read in our own history books on African history that black Africans, e.g. the Falasha of Ethiopia, were Jews long before Christianity or Islam made an appearance on the scene. Black Americans now are in a position as never before in modern history to rediscover and reclaim, if they wish, a heritage which has profoundly influenced world history and mankind, the Hebrew.
The other 11 tribes are still in Africa. The tribe Gad is believed to be South Africa. Listen to this prophecy in Genesis. Gad, a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at the last. This is exactly what happened to the Zulu people of South Africa in 1879 in Anglo-Zulu War between the British Empire and the Zulu Kingdom. The British defeated the Zulus after a string of battles in South Africa. The Zulu Kingdom has been subjugated by their British leaders for over 100 years, until Nelson Mandela became the president of South Africa in 1994. This set off a chain of events that caused the descendants of the Zulus regain control of their country. Now the Zulus run their government and are now taking back farms and lands that were owned by whites. They have overcome the troop in these last days. No other Israelite nation on the planet has this testimony. The scripture also states, "And of Gad he said, Blessed be he that enlargeth Gad. He dwelleth as a lion, and teareth the arm with the crown of the head." Currently, the Zulus are the largest South African ethnic group, with an estimated 10 or 11 million people.
During Shaka Zulu's time, the Zulu nation grew rapidly to 2 million square miles, consisting of 250,000 citizens and 40,000 soldiers. Notice the crown of the Zulu's head, a huge crown made of feathers. Look closely, and you will see some very sharp, huge horns, which would teareth the arm with the crown of the head, just like the scripture says.
This is more proof that the so-called mixed-race Native Americans are not the tribe of Gad. When have they overcome the European settlers and taken back their land in this last day?
The prophecy says that when the Messiah returns at the time of the Most High's wrath, he's going to gather his people from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, but Judah from the four corners of the earth.
Isaiah chapter 11, verse 10 through 12. And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. And it shall come to pass in that day that Yahuwah shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria, from Egypt, from Pathros, from Cush, from Elam, from Shinar, and from Hamath, and from the isles of the sea. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations, and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. Zephaniah 3, verse 8 through 10. Therefore wait ye upon me, saith Yahuwah, until the day that I will rise up to the prey, for my determination is to gather the nations, that I may assemble the kingdoms to pour upon them my indignation, even all my fierce anger. For all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. For then I will turn to the people a pure language, that they all may call upon the name of Yahuwah to serve him with one consent. From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my supplements, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring mine offering.
The river of Ethiopia is the river of Cush. Ethiopia is Cush. If you look at a modern map of Ethiopia, you won't see the true boundaries of ancient Ethiopia, which is Cush. You have to look at an ancient map of Cush. This is an ancient map of Cush.
Here is Ethiopia, and as you can see, beyond the rivers of Ethiopia would be in the direction of all the places where Negro slaves were captured, and where others are still calling themselves Jews. Beyond the rivers of Ethiopia would be Ghana, Nigeria, and other areas in Africa.
Sing joyfully to sing joyfully, all right, so before Adonai, for the upright race is speaking. Give thanks to Adonai with the harp, with the dancing leg. Make music to him, sing to him a new song. Play well with the sound of deepest feeling. For upright is the word of Adonai, and all his deeds are done with faithfulness. He loves charity and justice, the kindness of Adonai feel that. By the word of Adonai the heaven were made, and by the praise of his mouth all their hosts. He assembled like a wall the waters of the sea. He blessed as all those designed to against me. He modified their counsel and did not the other than. Half for your name's sake, half for your right hand's sake, half for your sanctity's sake, half for your children's sake, that your beloved one may be given rest. Let your right hand step and respond to me. Bless the vision of my mouth and the top of my heart. For I favor before you, Adonai, my rock and my redeemer. You make peace in our eyes, may you make peace upon us, and upon all this world and respond. Amen. May he be of you that is not like grace of the grace of our God, that the holy temple be received in our days, grant us our share in your Torah, and may we say today we represent us in days of old and in former years, that the offering of you and our years Lord in this in your life, and the days of who I mean for my years. Amen.
May God be your power, be with you. May God tonight be with you. And sunshine upon you and give you peace. May God be with you. And sunshine upon you and give you
and the migration story of the people of the Adangbes was that almost all the ethnic groups in Ghana migrated from somewhere before the early, let's say, 15th century.
Okay.
Our history goes deeper. In fact, the ancient Ghana Empire that even inspired our first president to take the name Ghana was a vast territory. It engulfs almost the whole of the sub-Saharan western part of Africa, right after the desert.
Yeah.
That shows you how vast the indigenous people have traveled all the way before they come and settle here.
Mm.
So the different tribes, the different ethnic groups within the Greater Accra got these differences through the migration patterns
They
used before they arrived here in the place we call Accra.
Mm.
The Adangbes and the people of the Gans, the people who speak Ghana, the Adangbes speak a different dialect known as the Dangbe.
Mm.
The Dangbe is like a sister country to the Gan language.
Okay.
And they've written book and they have a history, especially the indigenous people of here have a direct history of migration through Israel, especially the indigenous people of here have a direct history of migration through Israel, especially the indigenous people of here have a direct history of migration through Israel, especially the indigenous people of here have a direct history of migration through Israel.
Also, we're going to bring clarification to the scripture that talks about Ephraim being a cake unturned. When you have a cake unturned, just think of a pancake, for instance. One side is dark and the other side that's up is not dark because it hasn't been put to the fire yet. So a lot of people are using that to say that Ephraim is mixed, or that's proof that Ephraim is mixed, when in all actuality that scripture was actually talking about Ephraim mixing with the other nations' cultures, therefore making him lukewarm. So it had nothing to do with his appearance. Nothing at all indicates that has something to do with his appearance, but more so that mingling with these other nations and taking on their cultures and their beliefs has caused Ephraim to be waxed lukewarm. Much has been uncovered, and it is clear that the Israelite tribes have been misrepresented by the so-called 12 tribes chart in an attempt to wipe them out. Our heritage is literally being given to another people and passed around like a free lunch. As stated in the book of Baruch, we should not give that which is profitable unto us to other nations. Now you have us claiming that people that have a Mongoloid or Spanish mixture are Israelites when they are not. All 12 tribes were and still are Negroes. Now as for those that may have some European in their blood as a result of being raped by our former slave masters, we must remember that when you breathe back into black or Israelite blood for more than three consecutive generations, you stamp out that other seed line. This was shown in the example in White It Out Part 1, and is also confirmed in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 8. When the original seed line is interrupted by this raping or the mixing of our blood, the Most High says in Joel 3 and 21 that He's going to cleanse our blood. You know, He had foreknowledge of what was going to happen to us, which is why He already had a plan in place. Knowing all of this, we can't continue to transgress the Most High's laws by using a false chart to create false lineages based on false superficial markers of who the Israelites are. The Bible already tells us how to identify them in the last days, and for us to try to reason within ourselves that because Hawaiians may say aloha that they're from the tribe of Naphtali, that's pure nonsense. Or that the Venezuelans are Asher because of the oil that's in their land, that's just pure conjecture. There's oil all over the planet, so that's a moot point for determining who the tribe of Asher is. There are areas in Africa that have oil, and the land is rich. As a matter of fact, Africa probably has the richest soil and the greatest resources on the planet. This is why the land has been raped and plundered and pillaged and robbed for centuries by the same people who raped the populations of indigenous people worldwide. All of this raping going on, it kind of coincides with Matthew the 13th chapter, which talks about how the wicked one was going to go about sowing his seed in the earth and bringing forth children among the wheat. They call those tares. See now, all of this gets kind of deep when you start putting things into perspective. So trying to pretend like some Israelites are black and then now they're all of a sudden almost white because of mixing, but disregarding the fact that the Most High told us not to mix with these other nations to begin with, that's ludicrous if you claim to be all about the truth. The fact of the matter is, there was a plan conjured up by whomever to justify marrying women of other nations and diminishing the so-called Israelite seed.
The bottom line is, those that established the 12 tribes chart have an agenda. They are joining themselves with strange women and establishing their own righteousness. 1 Esdras chapter 9 verse 8 states, "Ye have transgressed the law in marrying strange wives, thereby ye have increased the sins of Israel." The establishment of the 12 tribes chart has shook the very foundation of our awakening and sent many into a tailspin. We've already had to endure having our entire culture taken by those that claim to be Jews and are not. But now we want to just give our heritage to another? The world is awakening to who the true Israelites are. Isaiah, the 14th chapter, got folks reconsidering this 1940 so-called regathering of the Jews in Israel, because it has been the total opposite of what the Bible said would happen. Instead of the world being at peace and breaking forth with singing, it has been utter chaos and war with those so-called Jews. The establishment of who we are as Israelites does not mean that other nations cannot be grafted into the Messiah. But we can't just go around pistoling their tribes to satisfy our lust for strange women. This is a direct rebellion against the word and the will of the Father. The Bible clearly shows where the true Israelites are and where the Messiah is going to gather his people. Judah, he's going to gather from the four corners of the earth. But the other tribes, he will gather from beyond the rivers of Cush in Africa. Isaiah chapter 11 verse 10 through 14 has got to be the most ignored passage in the scriptures. I know all these Bible scholars and teachers and preachers have seen this passage and yet they choose to ignore it. I wonder why. The last thing that Gentiles want you to know is that the 12 tribes of Israel are Negro and that the remaining lost tribes are in Africa. The wicked have been trying for years to wipe out the seed of Israel and the entire planet. They want our Hebrew brothers to take Gentiles as wives to whiten out our offspring. So now we have a wicked chart that tells us that Gentiles are Hebrews. If we don't stand against this, we're going to be wiped out.
Your Bible tells you that Israelites would be scattered throughout the four corners of the earth, and yet your chart doesn't include any tribes from Africa or other areas. Interesting. You might as well just believe that I'm your savior if you're going to believe that chart.
Pay attention to what they
don't
say. They don't care about your life anyway.
Care.
Put us in ships and brought us here to be slaves. They took our true identities away.
Tell me,
do you know who you are?
Do you know?
You have the bloodline of kings.
Kings.
Like Malachim, shining bright like the stars. You are his,
cry. Let me tell you a little about your history. Since our family tree became a mystery, some people can only trace it to their great-great-grandparents, which only started in this place. But what about before we came to America? Before the boats and the chains was impairing us. Before Africa, when we was in our land, speaking the language as a people we can understand. See, they really never tell us that we Hebrew, because the blood of the Messiah in our people. They got the world thinking it's them, no, they fake Jews. The Ashkenazis in our land, they full of hate too. Yeshua said it the best, I listened like a child. Jerusalem should be trotting down by the Gentiles. I heard it clear, and I know that it's Yah's will, because the prophecy he spoke had to be fulfilled.
Don't pay attention to what they say. They don't care about your life anyway. Put us in ships and brought us here to be slaves. They took our true identities away. Tell me, do you know who you are?
Do you know?
You have the bloodline of kings, like Mount King, shining bright like the stars. You are his bride. After the siege in Jerusalem, we fled west into Africa, living with hound flesh. Some of us taken by the Romans into slavery, where we were forced to worship idol pagan deities. Some of us fell by the sword in our own land. We tried to fight back without the Father's hand. As a result, we were dispersed among all nations, given the curses in the Torah, ending Yah's patience. While in Africa, they started to afflict us, as in the days of old, like when in Egypt. Then we went further west, they called it Negroland, where famine ran high and it was full of sand. They couldn't understand why Judah wouldn't die out, cause Kumbaya Yahushua was in my mouth. And then the Europeans came with a resolution, bought us with guns and rum, started a revolution.
Don't pay attention to what they say. They don't care about your life anyway. Put us in ships and brought us here to be slaves. They took our true identities away.
Tell me,
do you know?
You have the bloodline of kings, like Mount King, shining bright like the stars. You are his bride.
Now we on the slave ship in the Atlantic Ocean, a yoke of iron on our neck, dead bodies floating, whipped and beat on our way to captivity. Nothing to eat, feeling weak, they died in their sleep. Can't enjoy my brother, can't enjoy my sister, because they sold his bond man to the highest bidder. Serving a God who me nor my fathers know. Wooden cross, stone, Jesus, need I say more? Pagan day of worship, honoring the sun. They call it Christianity, look what we become. Israel, you got the blood of a mighty king. You can accomplish things beyond your wildest dreams. And all you have to do is turn to his law. To keep the commandments is the duty of us all. Live righteous, continue doing well, and praise Yah, you are his bride.
Don't pay attention to what they say. They don't care about your life anyway. Put us in ships and brought us here to be slaves. They took our true identities away.
Tell me, do you know who you are?
Do you know?
You have the bloodline of kings, like Mount King, shining bright like the stars. You are his bride.